proved in liberating strife. Since the beginning of the Revolutionary War of 1775 and our following Declaration of Independence on July 4, 1776, we as Americans have been involved in over 100 conflicts. Throughout these conflicts, one family, like so many others, has been an active part of Americans' military history. Our story begins with Christopher Douglas, a Union Army soldier in the Civil War. The time is June of 1863. What was unique about this war was that the enemy was not a foreigner, but a fellow countryman. At any moment, a man could be firing upon a man who was once a friend. This war split friendships and families across the nation. But as General Lee once wrote to General Longstreet, "It is well that war is so terrible, else we should grow too fond of it." Christopher hails from northwestern county of Virginia, where the residents did not wish to secede along with the rest of the state. In the summer of 1861, Union troops under General George McClellan drove off Confederate troops under General Robert E. Lee from the area. Following this, the residents held a series of two meetings known as the Wheeling Convention, which ultimately repealed the ordinance of secession passed by Virginia, allowing them to form their own government until they were later recognized by the Union as a state. Here we find Christopher Douglas writing a letter to his cherished family.
"My dearest Annabelle, these are very troubling times we find ourselves in. The Confederate Army, led by General Lee, defeated our forces a fortnight ago at Winchester. It chills my soul to the bone to know that a battle occurred so close to our very own homestead. What comforts me now is to know that just this day of June 20th, 1863, us, our neighbors, and loved ones have been admitted into the Union as the great state of West Virginia. Tomorrow, I ride out with General Hooker to follow General Lee. The troops are hopeful we will succeed in our venture. I feel more worried because I know that General Hooker has been quite uncomfortable with his commander, General Halleck. But do not fret. I am confident our men, for they are strong in body, mind, and soul. I must declare it shall be the eeriest of feelings crossing roads that are familiar, knowing that I will not be using them to go home. However, with my own personal objections towards slavery and the war pushed aside, I do not regret my decision to join the Union forces. Why, just yesterday, I shared a piece of bread with our neighbor's boy, young Tommy Dowling. As a surgeon, I am here helping men to survive these horrific battles. Any normal human being would not be able to fathom the horrors I have witnessed since the beginning of the war. I pray that our great country will never have to endure such tragedy ever again. I will not trouble you with such worries. Please kiss young Beatrice and Jonathan on their tender foreheads for me. Tell them Father will be home as soon as he can. Your devoted husband, Christopher Douglas."
In World War I, when soldiers returned home, the only thing they could expect was $60 in mustering out pay and a train ticket home. Then and prior, soldiers returning from battle received no benefits to help them transition back into civilian life. Because of this recognizable gap following World War I, The American Legion was formed in 1919 by war-weary veterans fighting for exiting bonuses and additional benefits that would take years to approve. The benefits the American Legion fought for might have gained government approval earlier. However, these efforts were slowed by the coming of the Great Depression. Unemployment and homelessness became a common standard for World War I veterans during these times. Years later, in 1939, when the Great Depression ended, World War II began. During this war, efforts to gain veterans' benefits were rejuvenated from fears Americans possessed that the tens of thousands of soldiers deployed would return to the same fate suffered by those from World War I. And so the Servicemen's Readjustment Act of 1944 was signed, more commonly known as the GI Bill. The GI Bill is one that almost died before it was ever born. In Congress, the House and Senate passed several different versions during the spring of 1944. A joint committee of two houses was appointed to try and work out the differences. Seven senators and seven representatives were appointed. Any agreement required a majority vote from both sides. The committee had a deadline of 10 a.m. on June 10th to reach an agreement or the bill would die. A proposed compromise won the support of all seven senators, but the House members split 3-3, with one member absent. The missing member, Congressman John Gibson of Georgia, had left a proxy vote in favor of the compromise with the chairman of the House delegation, John Rankin of Mississippi. However, because Mr. Rankin was opposed to the compromise, he refused to exercise Mr. Gibson's proxy to break the tie. At 6 p.m., the night before the deadline, Gibson was still absent and all seemed lost. The American Legion intervened, determined to see the bill pass. They arranged radio broadcasts requesting Gibson's whereabouts because they had come to find out he was on the road somewhere in Georgia, unable to be located. An employee from the supporting Atlanta Constitution called Gibson's home every 5 minutes. When Gibson was finally located at approximately 11 p.m., he was escorted by police to a nearby military base. From there, he was driven in a military vehicle to Jacksonville, Florida, where the American Legion had a plane waiting to take him to Washington. Less than 3.5 hours before the deadline, the bill was approved by the committee. From there, it took only 12 days to sign into law. Here, in 1945, we have come to the end of World War II, and we find Christopher Douglas, great-grandson Douglas Evans, asleep on a train while on his way home from World War II.
Oh, I am so glad this war is over and I'm going home. I am so glad. I must admit though, I was a little stressed because I didn't know what I was gonna do. But then I heard about this GI Bill. I sure did. You see, my father, Christopher Douglas Evans, and my mother had saved up enough money for me to go to college. However, the Great Depression came, and all that money they saved up was spent, and it was exhausted, just exhausted. It was hard times, very hard times. Then the war kicked off. The war kicked off, and I got drafted. I wasn't even 18 yet, and here they were sending me off to Europe to fight a war. I got to Europe and met a Sergeant Brown. Sergeant Brown took me under his wings. He sure did. He took me under his wings and really helped me out. I'd be over there in Europe, laying in that snow, counting the snowflakes. Me, the snow, and the snowflakes. I just was. You know, Sergeant Brown would come along and say, "Charge!" And we would get up and charge. We didn't know what we was doing, but we'd charge anyway. You see, Sergeant Brown was what I call maybe a hero. Not all of us came back. No. What was I talking about? Oh, education. See, my father told me that I need to get a good education. Get a good education. See, my great-grandfather, Christopher Douglas, was some kind of Civil War hero. I believe he was a surgeon. I don't know about that hero stuff. You know, because most of us, when we were in the war, we were just trying to come back alive. That's all we were concerned about, not looking at a hero. Like I said before, if there was a hero, it was Sergeant Bryan. He sure it was. But I'm going to tell you this, for sure, I'm going to use that GI Bill. I sure am. Because I heard that they will pay your tuition, they will pay your fees, and they give you a $50 a month stipend. I'm going to use that. I bet you that. Hey, I think this is my stop. You have a nice day, mister.
I'm sure we all wish the best for our friend Douglas Evans. It really sounded like he knew what he was going to do when he got home from what he was talking to me about. You know, the thing about communication is, no matter what war you're a part of, it was always of utmost importance to almost every soldier one would meet. For many generations, the only form of communication was written letters. Even today, depending on where you go, writing is used by loved ones to stay in touch. Wars have often been defined by the new technologies that shape them. The Civil War was the first photographed war in U.S. history. News of World War II was delivered by movie newsreels. Television made Vietnam the living room war. And Desert Storm was the first war broadcast live by satellite. The Iraq campaign was a war that was accessible from your fingertips. Here we find the grandson of Douglas Evans, Andrew Evans, about to Skype with his wife.
Come on, answer the phone. Please answer. Hey, baby, how you doing today? I'm all right. Bored. Just got off mission. Yeah, it was long. Like usual. Hey, let me see the dog. Aw. All right, I'm good. I'll talk to you again. How you doing, babe? No, I'm sorry about last time we talked. No, just been stressed out a lot. Well, it's not that I don't trust you. I'm just not a big fan of your friends. Because they skeezy. Nah, the last 2 weeks been crazy, though. Like, did I tell you about the bathroom thing? Oh, my goodness. So, there I was. I was on guard duty the other day, right? Hey, fix your camera. Hey. All right. That's better. Anyway, I was on guard, right, and I'm in full battle rattle. And, well, I gotta, you know, go to the bathroom. So, I stumble out of the tower, and I get down to the bathroom, and, you know, I'm still in all this gear. Well, I'm doing my thing. I'm sitting there, and I'm like, what is on my leg? And I look down, there's a spider. I'm telling you, it was bigger than my leg. I freaked out. I took off running, screaming like a little girl, jumping up and down on it. And then everybody's looking out the tower, and there I am with a rifle jumping up and down on a spider like a little girl. Well, sort of a little girl. Anyway, yeah. But now CK won't even come to my room because I got a new roommate, and it's this big green snake. I don't know. It's scary. He throws rocks in my room now. He won't even come near my room. Now if there's something going down, they throw rocks. They won't even come to my door. Keeps me from going on, you know, fire guard and stuff, so that works. But don't worry, I'm taking care of myself, I guess. You know, my grandfather, Douglas Evans, he taught me a lot of tricks, you know, how to get by. So it all worked out in the long run. Yeah, it's a lot slower. This tour is a lot slower than my first one. I mean, they even made me go see mental health. You know, I just went in and talked to them, you know, because I'm sleeping, I'm depressed. Well, so they made me go to mental health. I have never even been to sick call. They made me go to mental health. That felt weird. Well, thank you. I'm not that weird. But anyway, so yeah, I had to go in there and they said something about, you know, If my brain's just not releasing serotonin like it used to. I don't know. I mean, I had such an adrenaline rush the last time I was out here. And this time it just slowed right down. You know, all the ROEs have changed. I mean, I don't know. It's all just different. I don't know. But now they won't give me medication because it could say it could affect my mental readiness and effectiveness. I don't know. It doesn't make sense to me. Let me see the dog again. Aww. All right, babe. Well, I'll talk to you when I get a chance. I don't know next time we're gonna be around the computers, but I love you, and I gotta go to bed, but I love you, and I'll talk to you soon. All right, bye.
Specialist Andrew Evans' emotional situation is one that is not uncommon amongst veterans from the Iraq War. Nearly 20% of military service members returning from Iraq and Afghanistan live with PTSD and or major depression, and yet only half of those service members have sought treatment. Of those who do start treatment, between 20 and 50% walk away before it's complete. Studies show that a soldier might drop out of PTSD and depression therapy for a variety of reasons, including a lack of trust for mental health professionals, a belief that psychological problems tend to work themselves out, or a perception that seeking mental health treatment should be a last resort. Soldiers also tend not to like the idea of open-ended therapies. One theory to battle this phenomenon is to reduce the stigma associated with PTSD and depression. Fortunately for Specialist Evans, he has a strong familial support back home, and they have been attending PTSD and depression seminars offered by his unit's FRGs, preparing for his return. Speaking about Specialist Evans' family, here's his wife now sitting down reading a book.
Hey, Mama. So, I have something really important that I want to talk to you about.
Oh my goodness, you're not pregnant, are you? I am going to kill your father. I told him we shouldn't let you
go. Oh my gosh, no, no. Come on now, really?
Oh my gosh, I am so sorry, honey. But don't ever start a conversation saying I have something very important to tell you. We're graduation right around the corner. You don't know what kind of crazy stuff is going through my head right now.
I mean, if that's what you really think, just forget I ever said anything. Just, you know, I'm just gonna go. This is just, forget about it.
Don't go nowhere, Gina. You know, with your father being gone, with him starting to be gone, with the Army and everything and overseas, I worry about you and your brother so much.
Well, you know, okay, so, you know how I've been going back and forth about what I want to do with my future? And I haven't really been deciding on what I want to do. I've been going back and forth between going to college and work or trade school. And, you know, I know that you and Daddy really want me to go back to school, like right into school, but we don't qualify for financial aid because Daddy works overseas, and I can't use his military benefits because he didn't transfer it to me right as soon before he got out of the military. So, you know, it's not like I really did all that great in high school anyway.
So, what are you trying to say?
Well, so I was thinking that maybe I could join the military.
What?
Yeah, well, but not the Army. Okay. So I was thinking more along the lines of the Air Force. And I even went and talked to a recruiter, and they said that I can maybe take classes while I'm enlisted, just here and there, kind of get a feel for it.
Didn't you learn from your father? Once he joined the military, he was never home. He was home gone majority of his deployment, his enlistment.
I know, but that was Dad. And I talked to the Air Force recruiter, and they said that the Air Force does like a band system. And on this band system, according to the MOS that I'm interested in, like the various types of MOSs, they fall within a band where I'll only get deployed a maximum of 6 months, and that's every 24 months. So really, technically, I'd only be deployed every 24 months, and that's 6 months. So it's nowhere near as close to as much as what Dad got deployed.
Okay, and what about how your father is now? You know, he was never the same after war. You know war changes people, Gina. I'm just afraid that you won't be able to tolerate the things that he's seen. You're my little girl. I don't want you to go.
I know. But, Mom, you can't protect me forever. I mean, I know that you feel that way, but I mean, I want to serve my country. I mean, Dad did, Grandpa Evans did, even great-great-great-great-grandpa Christopher Douglas did. I mean, this is something that our family has done throughout its whole existence. And I want to be the first woman to be in the military. I really think that I can make a difference, Mama. I really do.
You've always been a headstrong girl. You're going to do what you want to do, Gina. It's not up to me. I'm not going to be the person to stand in your way. All I ask you to do is promise me that you're going to be careful and you're going to come home to me.
Of course I will. Of course. You know.
Good heavens, Gina. I worry about you and your brother. And this right here, it scares me.
Well, I'm not going to have a combat MOS. So, and it's the Air Force. You know, I'll be okay. Okay, I love you, Mama.
I love you too.
I'm not sure how I would feel if my child wanted to join the military, but it is something to think about. Just one person's enlistment can be the start of a very long military legacy, just like this one. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kirk Dranchesky. I'm worksite at VA Veteran Services. Go 49ers.
And what you did in the
military? I was a 14 Tango. I worked for Air Defense Artillery, Patriot Missiles, served 5 years, deployed once to Kuwait.
Gordon Holberg, served 5 years, 2 Iraq deployments.
I'm Jocelyn Holmberg, president of the Student Veterans Organization, also a proud member of the Veterans Services Department here at CTC. I was a medic in the Army and I was medical boarded.
Hello, I'm Shante Campbell. I work up at the Veterans Service Department. I was in the military, in the Army for 4 years, IETS out of Fort Hood, and I deployed one time to Iraq.
I'm Terry Cass, and I'm also with the Veterans Services, 20-year vet, personnel management, that's what I did, coordinator of Veterans Services.
I'm Justin Egan, 6 years in the Marine Corps, crew chief on C-130s and infantry, working Veterans Services as a work study, and also a member of the Student Veterans Organization.
Thank you.
Thank you.